My name is the Reverend Nigel Irons, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to St Edward's Church in Leek on
for
this
our all-age celebration service, which will begin by using our opening responses.
Let us worship God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Because Jesus died for us, we thank you and praise you. Because Jesus rose again, we thank you and praise you. Because Jesus loves us, we thank you and praise you. Because Jesus is alive, we thank you and praise you. And now we'll sing our first song.
Hosannis in Dumise, Hosannis in Dumise, Yukosi amakosi, Gumsin disiwam. Hosannis in Dumise, Hosannis in Dumise, Yukosi amakosi, Gumsin disiwam.
Who paints the skies? Who paints the skies into glorious day? Only the splendor of Jesus, who breathes life into fists of clay. Only the splendor of Jesus, who shapes the valleys and brings the rain. Only the splendor of Jesus, who makes the desert to live again. Teach every nation his marvelous ways. Each generation shall sing his praise. He is wonderful, he is glorious, clothed in righteousness, full of tenderness. Come and worship him, he's the Prince of Life. He will cleanse our hearts in his river of fire.
Yeah, come on.
Who hears the cry of the barren one?
Only the mercy of Jesus.
Who breaks the curse of the heart of stone?
Only the mercy of Jesus.
Storms the prison and sets men free.
Yes, only the mercy of Jesus,
purchasing souls for eternity.
Only the mercy of Jesus.
Teach every nation his marvelous way. Each generation shall sing his praise.
Yeah. He is wonderful, he is glorious, clothed in righteousness, full of tenderness. Come and worship him, he's the Prince of Life. He will cleanse our hearts in his
he heart. Is wonderful.
He is wonderful, he is glorious, clothed in righteousness, full of tenderness. Come and worship him, he's the Prince of Life. He will cleanse our hearts in his river of fire.
Let's lift our voices and tell him what we think of our Lord Jesus. He's wonderful.
Let us say together, Lord, direct our thoughts and teach us to pray. Lift up our hearts to worship you in spirit and in truth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we come to confess our sins, trusting in the mercy of our Heavenly Father, as we join in saying together, Lord Jesus, I know that I have things to say sorry for. I am sorry that I was not always kind last week. I am sorry that I was not always helpful last week. I am sorry that I got cross sometimes last week. I am sorry that I hurt people who care about me last week. Please help me to be different this week. Help me to be more like you, Jesus. Amen. May God, our Heavenly Father, who is always ready to forgive those who are truly sorry, have mercy on you, forgive you your sins, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song we will praise our God. And now we'll sing our second song.
Our Bible reading today is from the book of the prophet Jonah, chapter 3. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message I give you. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. Now Nineveh was a very large city. It took 3 days to go through it. Jonah began by going a day's journey into the city, proclaiming, 40 more days, and Nineveh will be overthrown. The Ninevites believed God. A fast was proclaimed, and all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. When Jonah's warning reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, took off his royal robes, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat down in the dust. This is the proclamation he issued in Nineveh. by the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let people or animals, herds or flocks, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink, but let people and animals be covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently on God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Who knows? God may yet relent and with compassion turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask you now to meet us afresh as we reflect on your word, and by the power of your Holy Spirit, give us ears to hear, minds to understand, and hearts to receive your truth. In Jesus' name, amen. A woman was talking to her friend and noticed she was wearing a new locket on a chain round her neck. She asked her friend what was in it. "It's a lock of my husband's hair," she replied. "I keep it as a memento."
"Oh," replied the first woman, "but isn't your husband still alive?"
"Yes," said her friend, "but his hair is gone." As we go through life, changes take place, and we sometimes find ourselves looking back nostalgically on how things were in the past and wishing that they could still be so. At such times, there's a discrepancy between the reality of our lives and our desire, which is for something different. And it's the subject of desire that I want us to think about today. It seems true that the greater we desire something, the more committed we will be to pursuing it. Although desiring something doesn't always make it happen, desire itself can be a very good thing if it's focused in the right direction. And our reading from Jonah teaches us this very clearly. Jonah is sent to the town of Nineveh with a message from God. And effectively what this message does is to test their desire. God says to them, in effect, "Do you really desire to avoid my judgment? Because if you do, then you need to repent and start behaving differently." And the story shows us that the people of Nineveh search themselves and take God's message to heart. They do repent and they do start behaving differently because they really desire to please God. Changing the way they behave, along with repenting, is how they demonstrate the reality of their desire. Anyone can say, "I'm sorry." But if the words are true, they cannot be spoken without having an effect, which is why it's good to regularly confess our sins, because if we mean what we are saying, it encourages us to look at where we are and what we need to let God change. As part of our Christian faith, we need to be open enough to allow God to ask us how serious we are about our walk with him and about examining how much our inner desire to love him more dearly, see him more clearly, and follow him more nearly actually spills over into the way we behave. And then we need to be willing to make changes if we are serious about pleasing God, and to be prepared to deny ourselves, as Jesus did. Jesus told a story about two men, a Pharisee and a tax collector, going into the temple to pray. On the face of it, they both had a desire to be accepted by God. But one of them, the Pharisee, is going about it the wrong way. His desire is to please God on his own terms. In other words, he chooses how to please God,
rather than actually listening to what God has to say about how we should please him. The Pharisee sets his own terms and conditions. I'm not a rogue. I'm not an adulterer. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all my income. And he meets these terms and conditions and then brings himself to God and says, accept me. Be pleased with me. But Jesus says that is not actually what God wants. The tax collector, on the other hand, comes and admits his sinfulness and asks God to show him mercy. And he goes away justified and restored. Now, of course, Jesus isn't saying that what we do isn't important. As we have already seen, it is by what they did that the people of Nineveh showed the reality of their desire. And the New Testament makes it clear in many places that words alone are emptied of their meaning if they are not supported by the choices we make in our everyday lives. Presumably, the tax collector would have gone on to change his ways if he was genuinely conscious of his need for God's mercy. And presumably, and this is the important point, the Pharisee did not change his ways because he thought that everything he was doing was already okay. What Jesus is challenging us to think about here is where we get our idea of what really pleases God from. If our idea of what really pleases God is wrong, then it needs to be changed. The reason this story was so shocking was that most of the people who heard Jesus describing the Pharisee would have thought, yes, here is a man whose life must be really pleasing to God. They thought that doing all those things was the way to please God. But Jesus came to show us that that isn't what it's about. That actually nothing we can do earns us any eternal points. What we do reveals what our desire is. But if our desire is set on pleasing God in our own way rather than his, then it is focused in the wrong place. The desire God wants to see more than anything else is the desire that the Holy Spirit will continue to change us. And the extent to which we have that desire will depend on how well we think we are doing already. In many areas of life, we set out on a particular path, and as we gain experience, we become more confident and less reliant on the help of others. But being a Christian is completely different. As a Christian, we need the help and grace and mercy and power and love of Jesus just as much at the moment of our death as we do at the moment of our conversion. Because following Christ is not about learning to depend on ourselves, but learning to depend on him. And it's that dependence that Jesus is highlighting in this story. The tax collector is justified rather than the Pharisee because the tax collector knows that he needs to depend on God. His desire and will are focused on dependence. The Pharisee is condemned because he thinks he has made it. He doesn't realize that he still needs to depend on God just as much as he ever did. He has left no room for self-examination and acknowledgement of his own need and reliance on God. As we grow in our faith and understanding, what actually should happen is that we become more and more aware of our sinful human nature and of our need to stand only in God's grace, rather than becoming like the Pharisee who became complacent and imagined that God was pleased with him because of the things he had done. And that's where the centre of the issue lies. We know that when we come to Christ, he wants to change us. But Jesus doesn't just want to change us, He wants to totally transform us. And that can be really hard to accept. If we've been Christians for a long time, we might imagine that we've allowed Jesus to deal with 75% or 80% of the things we think needed to be changed. And we might imagine that's enough. After all, 75 or 80% is a lot. But God hasn't finished with any of us yet. And the danger that Jesus is warning us about in this parable is the danger of thinking that he has. So let's ask Jesus to show us what he wants to do with us next. To be willing to be challenged by looking at the things that we still need to let him work on. To express our desire to please him by taking notice of what he says, like the people of Nineveh, and by surrendering ourselves to him, like the tax collector. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, help us to continue depending on you and not on ourselves. Help us to resist the temptation to think that you are pleased with us simply because of our adherence to standards that we have set for ourselves. Lord Jesus, help us to know that you love us as we are, that we can come to you daily as we are, and that nothing can ever separate us from your love. Remind us that there is always a way back to you from wherever we may find ourselves. Holy Spirit, soften our hearts so that we are able to set aside our own pride and stubbornness. Help us to learn to surrender ourselves to you afresh each day and to listen and respond to your voice. Amen.
And now we'll sing our third song.
Splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice, 'cause he wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great's our God, sing with me, how great's our God, and all will see how great's our God. Age to age he stands, and time is in his sands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead, three in one, Father, lying in the lamb, how great's our God, sing with me, how great's our God, and all the sea, how great's our God. You're the name above.
So now we'll use the responsive version of the Creed. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Jesus known in the world? We believe and trust in him. This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. So now we'll use the five-finger prayer. Just to remind you what that's about. The thumb reminds us to pray for things that are good and that make us happy, to thank God for those good things. The index finger reminds us to pray for those who point us in the right direction, who teach us and guide us and help us to learn. The middle finger is there to remind us to pray for those in authority who make decisions about the way that we live. The ring finger is there to remind us to pray for our loved ones, and the little finger to pray for those who are weakest and most vulnerable. So, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the good things that we do still enjoy. We know that many, many people are facing lots of difficulties at the present time, and not everybody has all the things they're used to having, and some don't have enough at all. But we thank you for the good things we do have. We thank you that all good things come from you. And we thank you for our food, for our homes, and for our families. We pray, Heavenly Father, for all those who teach at this present time, either at school or in the church or in other contexts, colleges, universities. We pray for all students who are learning, that you'll help them to learn well, and that you'll help those who are teaching them to be able to give them access to the information that they need in order to grow in their knowledge and understanding. We pray for those who lead us. We ask you to help them to make good choices. We pray for the government and for all local councils and authorities, that you'll give them the wisdom they need to be able to see what is right and what is best, and the means and the will to do it, so that we can all live in the best possible way under the circumstances in which we find ourselves. And we pray for those we love. We ask you, Heavenly Father, to surround them with your care and your protection. We pray that we might be able to keep in touch with them, and we pray that they'll be encouraged by the contact that they have with us. Father, we pray for your blessing upon them as we think of them today. And finally, Father, we pray for those who are vulnerable or weak or unwell at this time. We pray, Father, for all those who are working to care for those who are poorly in hospital or at home, and to vaccinate those who are most at risk. We pray you strengthen them in their work and help them to do it well, and sustain their own commitment and sacrifice. We thank you for them all. We pray for those who are sad because they've lost loved ones. We pray that you'll surround them with your loving arms and remind them about the hope of Jesus Christ and the reality that one day everyone who believes and trusts in him will be together with you in your eternal kingdom, where there will be no pain or suffering anymore. Be close to all those in special need today, we pray. We ask all of these prayers in the name of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now we join together in saying the prayer that Jesus taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
And now we'll sing our fourth song. So we join in our final prayer. Jesus, thank you that you died on the cross for my sin. Thank you that you rose again so that I can have eternal life. And thank you that you are here with me now so that I can live for you every day. Amen. So now, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and in the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father who has created us, the Son who has redeemed us, and the Holy Spirit who breathes God's life, light, and love into our hearts, rest upon you, remain with you, guard you, guide you, keep you, and strengthen you in his service, today and always. Amen. Thank you for joining us for our service here today. We extend a warm invitation to you to join us again next week for our service of morning worship.